options for endowment investment. And as requested by the board in June, we're going to go over the various options. And then in the governing board full meeting, we have a recommendation. No further ado, here's Bob, and he's been advising us throughout this process, and he was also involved in developing the finance plan and the cost model for the habitat plan during the planning process. Okay, thank you.
Also, Supervisor Sabatian is on the line, so he's teleconferencing.
Okay, good afternoon, board. Thank you very much for having me. Just a little bit more about me, Robert Spencer. I've been in the public finance or in urban planning, what we call urban economics business, for about 30 years. Worked for several small, medium, and national consulting firms, serving nearly 99% local agencies throughout the city of California on issues related to growth and infrastructure and funding and financing. I've had the pleasure over the last 5 to 10 years of being deeply involved in developing funding plans for regional habitat conservation plans, including Santa Clara's. I authored the Nexus study that laid the groundwork for the development impact fees charged for your plan. I've worked on plans from San Joaquin County to Yolo, currently working with Placer County on their regional plan. So I'm very happy to continue doing this work for you. I would note that at this point, Santa Clara is out in front of the other plans, at least in Northern California, in terms of wrestling this endowment issue and taking affirmative action on it and dealing with it. The wildlife agencies, as with several policy aspects of these regional plans, they would learn from the last one and then integrate that learning into the next one. Well, when they got to Santa Clara, they realized they really had to require that the endowment start from day one, which really is the smartest idea certly from a financial and funding perspective. The other plans in California that are moving forward now, Yolo, Placer, are going to be doing the same thing. East Contra Costa has got to go back and, if you will, retrofit their plan 10 years in and add in an endowment. They were adopted before your plan. So that's something they're going to be addressing in the next year. So anyway, your action today could really send a very important signal around Northern California for other plans and the direction that may make the most sense. So happy to present a number of options, discuss the issues with you today. I'm going to summarize my memorandum that's in your packet with slides. I think, shall we keep this informal and take questions as we go? Would that make sense? Yeah. Why don't we do that? Let me make sure I can do this in, I guess, the arrow keys, right? There we go. So, post-permit term in perpetuity costs. Under the plan, you're obligated to fund an annual amount for ongoing monitoring and management of the reserve after the permit term finishes. The entire function of the endowment is to be built over the permit term with no withdrawals taken, so that these costs can then be funded out of the endowment post-permit. The costs will come in at about, in today's dollars, about $3 million a year, supporting about 4.5 FTEs, either in-house or on contract, to fulfill those functions that are required under the permit. So this is part of your permit obligations. Several key assumptions that go into calculating how big that endowment has to be. We're assuming that out of every impact fee paid, a certain percent, about 10%, is going to be squirreled away into this endowment. So you're going to build it as you go. And believe me, just like your 401k, your pension plan, or your kid's college account, you know it's best to do this on an ongoing basis from day one. And that's the same financial guidance that we're following here. We're assuming a 50-year permit term. That is the term in the permit. And of course, as I mentioned, no need for withdrawals until the end. And then a key metric that goes into the endowment calculation is what is the net return on investment on those funds over the 50 years. And by net, I mean after all management fees, after inflation, what amount gets rolled back into that balance every year. And this is often called the cap rate. It's a financial metric used by pension planners, endowment managers. It's what you think you're going to get on an ongoing basis after you take out everything else, including inflation. That number is 3.25% now in the endowment model that we used in the Nexus study, which went into calculating the development fees. That's a very reasonable rate, and I'd be happy to go into it in more detail if you like. It'll be coming up at several points in my presentation. You'll see references to that. Now, how do we get to that 3.25%? We're assuming an average annual return on investment of 7.25%. And then out of that, we're assuming inflation of 3% and endowment manager fees of 1%. That gets us to 3.25. I would say these are all relatively conservative assumptions. Certainly in today's environment, I wouldn't say that they're, you know, way low or high, but I would say, as you would expect when we're building something for a 50-year plan and we're just starting out, when we did this as part of the Nexus study to calculate the fees, we wanted to make sure that we weren't going to underfund the endowment. So I think the 3.25% is reasonable and conservative.
Thank you. Before you move on to the next slide, please, that's 7.25 was the biggest concern I had in this entire report. And I just wondered, I'm familiar with CalPERS. You know, their average return, it's certainly 20% below that over the last 5 to 10 years. I would rather see us err on the side of caution. And, you know, you can never have too much money. You can never have too much emergency fund, those kinds of things. Can you give me a little explanation, if you will, how you came to 7.25 based on what?
It came directly from the work that two habitat plans, or two, shall we say, endowment holders worked out in the 2009, 2010, 2011 period. One was the California Department of Fish and Wildlife. They realized that their endowments needed to be professionally managed to maximize their return. They looked for an entity to do that. They identified one of the options we're actually going to be talking about today, the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation, to manage those endowments. And then through NIFWF, as it's abbreviated, they came to this return goal of 7.25%. The other entity that played into this was something called the Renewable Energy Action Team. That was the consortium of government agencies, state and federal, including, again, California Department of Fish and Wildlife, that was driving the desert conservation plan, that large habitat conservation plan in the desert that was trying to address the impacts of large renewable energy projects. And again, that government agency group, the RIAT team, also went to NIFWF, actually adopted a slightly higher goal of 7.5%, but I'd say the 25 basis points is not really significant. So at the time when we were doing the Nexus study in 2011, it made perfect sense to draft off to what these other habitat endowment managers were doing. So that's where that came from. I think, to get right to it, CalPERS still has, I believe, a 7 to 7.5% goal. Now that's what they're.
Yeah, they do have that goal, and I don't. What I have here, I just brought some research I did on this. The 1 year return, 3 year return for CalPERS, 5 year return for CalPERS, 10 year return for CalPERS, and it's gone 6.9, 6.7, 5.1.
Yep. Yep.
Over a 10 year period.
Yep.
In a 1 year, 3 year, 5 year, 10 year, if they ever hit 7%.
Yep.
And that's why I'm so concerned about this
yep.
number going forward, especially if you're off, if you err If you estimate 7 1/4 and in fact you earn 6 3/4, year one, year two, okay, but as it compounds,
yep.
That differential
yep.
just balloons.
A couple more points on that. It's a very valid point. There is, I would say, a debate going on in the economics profession and in the endowment management profession whether these historical rates that these are based on, the 7, 7.5, whatever, are going to hold true going forward. It is not clear whether future returns to capital overall in the public markets are going to stay the same rates. And I think you're seeing pension funds gradually bring those targets down as a result in response to those historical returns. So I think
I appreciate. I'll just make my final comment on this and stop.
Sure.
I just wanted to get it out there on the record, express my concern.
Yeah. Okay.
CalPERS can pick the 7, 7.5% number. Oops, we came up short. They get on the phone
right.
and call all the cities right. in the county except for San Jose
right.
and say, hey, we came up short. Send us a check for 100,000, yeah. 8 million, whatever.
Yeah.
And they're fine. There's a lot of, when CalPERS sets a higher number, all the cities say, oh, wow, we have to put in less this year. But then each year they come up short.
Yeah.
And the cities then have to take that money out of their general fund from their police or their libraries or the streets or whatever to make up that difference, as does the county. Only once in my 13 years has it occurred we underestimated.
Yeah.
There was a stock market boom instead of a bust.
Yeah.
And they actually gave money back to cities. I would have preferred they just held on to that
yeah.
going into the next year. But that's why our organization here, if our estimates are incorrect, to my knowledge, and please correct me, the Habitat Agency cannot turn to cities and say, make up the difference.
No.
No, it can't. I'll make two final points on that. Number one, the funding plan and the fees are looked at from the bottom up, from the most trivial assumption up to the most important assumption every 5 years. So every 5 years, we would be going back, and this would be one of the assumptions we could look at. So actually, there is a mid-course. In fact, there will be multiple mid-course corrections every 5 years, and those would flow through to the funding plan and flow through to the fees.
Super.
But,
thank
so.
You. Good comment?
Go.
Yeah, this is Deborah Cowden from the Water District, along with Ann. We worked on this plan, and my recollection is we had a lot of conversations about the cap rate and ended up raising it because the county folks looked at it. The county finance were really helpful. But that was the point that I would have made, is that 5 year. This is probably something that does need to be looked at in our first 5 year audit.
Yep.
I would really highly recommend yep. it, and I think that's what you're What your concerns.
That would be
concerns.
Great, so we don't get too far behind.
Yeah.
I agree.
Thank you.
And
one last point.
One thing. So the percentage of the fees that go towards endowment can change. So right now it's 10.35%. So if the investment projections are not aligned with sort of what you're talking about, actual return on investment, then the percentage that goes towards endowment would increase. So it may increase to, let's say, 15% of the fees. Now, the downside of that is there's less for other things.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Thank you. I'm good on that.
I think.
Go ahead.
But also, to offset if there was a potential loss, you could raise the
yes.
impact fees too. So there
absolutely.
Are other mechanisms you could. Do
absolutely yep
yeah this cap rate assumption would be dealt like any other cost assumption in the model, gets trued up every 5 years. One last thing, and it's important to keep in mind the equation you see in front of you. Inflation, we've got it in here at 3%. It's only been 2.5% for the last 10 years, so we bought 50 basis points right there. And the manager fees, you'll see in later slides, the two options we're looking at are much closer to 50 basis points. So we actually have bought ourselves a full 100 basis points of potential downside on the investment returns here.
But Cooper, thank you.
You're focusing on exactly the right issues. Okay, let's try and get through this here efficiently. Okay, so the options we looked at, you could continue with the county commingled investment pool. We did not pursue that one because that pool has been returning about 60 to 70 basis points. Basis point is 0.01%, so about 0.6 to 0.7% per year. So it's where the model is assuming 7.25. This is like 1/10 of that for obvious reasons. The county is restricted by statute for the reasons that anybody in local government would be aware of, has to be very conservative, basically can't invest based on the goals of an endowment. So we need to look at an alternative. We looked at the in-house endowment management option, basically bringing that function inside. That really doesn't become cost effective until you're about $100 million in size. So maybe that'll be an option in the future, but it certainly isn't as we start out here, because we're starting from scratch. So we focused on the options 3 and 4, basically driven by the statute that the state, the legislature cleaned up the habitat endowment management world with some statutory amendments in, I think, 2011 or so. And they specifically mentioned in that statute that you could use a congressionally chartered foundation, which was really just a code word for NIFWIF, because NIFWIF is the only congressionally chartered foundation that works in this area. And or you could use a community foundation, which is a type of foundation that's registered and serves your local community. In this case, you're probably familiar with the Silicon Valley Community Foundation. So those are the two we focused on. We used these selection criteria. Investment performance, just what we were talking about, management team and structure, how much annual funding are they estimating we would receive from the endowment net of fees, what sort of connections do they have to the local community, and what sort of experience do they have with habitat endowments. So working through those criteria here with the two options we focused on, you can see the experience, investment experience of NIFWIF and Silicon Valley, and this is right back to the comments we heard about CalPERS. You can see that in the 7-year period, you know, they both surpassed the 7.25%. But depending upon what period you pick, it varies. I would say, having looked at, and I did a great degree of due diligence with these groups, and I'm really only giving you the very highest level here. I spent about 4 hours on the phone and read through multiple documents sent by both of these groups. So I would say that these returns are comparable to each other. They each have their own benchmarks that they measure against. You know, you can see in some cases they surpassed it, in some cases they didn't. But this is one of the criteria you'd want to look at, is your manager, do they have a historical record that's reasonable, in spite of the fact that, as any statement will say, historical returns are not a guarantee of future performance. So we have to be aware of that. So that's where we are in performance. On the structure, it was interesting, the differences. NIFWIF takes a very, and I don't mean this in a negative way, but they take a hands-off approach. They've hired Common Fund. Common Fund is a very well-regarded national financial manager based in New York. They're a nonprofit, which actually sets them apart from a lot of other investment managers. And they are focused more on public endowments, universities, hospitals, things like that. What the staff says, they negotiate an investment agreement with Common Fund with their targets, where they can invest, what the allocations could be by investment sector. And then they step back, they let Common Fund make all the decisions on where the money, what individual managers to pick, how to rebalance the portfolio over time. And they report then to NIFWIF on a monthly basis, if not more often. I mean, they have a very close connection. And NIFWIF staff is there to monitor, ensure that they're performing, and if not, NIFWIF can make a decision to move to a different manager. On the Silicon Valley side, it's somewhat, there's more internal decision making because of where Silicon Valley is, being a center of wealth and wealth management. There's actually a board-appointed investment committee composed of some, names that I certainly knew, very prominent and well-respected investment advisors in the Valley, and they work with the Community Foundation staff, and they have a consultant, Colonial Consulting, but Colonial Consulting acts more as a advisor that brings ideas and it helps advise on who to pick and how to rebalance. But the final decisions really rest with that investment committee. So it's more of an in-house structure, more tapping into the Valley's investment management expertise, whereas NIFWIF is looking to a large money manager who does this for a whole bunch of clients outside. Not sure there's an obvious plus and minus there, but it was an interesting difference. On the annual funding, we really wanted to take a look at those endowment manager fees very closely, the fees that NIFWIF and Silicon Valley would charge. You can see what each of them proposes to their clients in their modeling. NIFWIF does estimate 7.25 to 7.5. That's directly out of that agreement from 2011 or so with California Department of Fish and Wildlife and the REIT team. Silicon Valley thinks is now projecting 7.6%. So again, very close, really hard to distinguish. I use the same inflation assumption for both just to show apples and apples. And then you can see the fees there on the second to last line, nearly the same. Slightly 5 basis points higher on the Community Foundation side. An offset to that, which I believe I have on the next slide, is you can see that the fees for Silicon Valley, they drop more quickly as the endowment grows, whereas NIFWIF, they're at 1% until you hit 10 million, and then they drop to half a percent. To put this in the context of your current funds, I think we have about 2.5 to 3 million that'll be in the endowment by the end of the fiscal year.
Hopefully, yes.
Yeah. So you're working your way to that 10 million, and you'll unless we have a gigantic downturn in the building cycle, which is always possible, you'll get to that 10 million, that lowest fee structure amount, fairly quickly. But there is a slight difference there as you build up. So that's on the annual funding side. Then we had a couple other criteria that were more intangibles that we wanted to put forward, just again as a way to basically just try and differentiate between these two options. So with regards to connection to the local community, clearly Silicon Valley has that. They potentially open up avenues for additional contributions to the plan, say through private foundations and others, a line item that we actually do have in the funding plan. We have a line item for private foundations to help cover some of the cost of the plan going forward. So they obviously have that going in their favor. On the final criteria, experience with habitat endowments, I mean, this is what NIFWIF does. This is a big part of their business, is managing these endowments nationwide, from small, less than $100,000 to extremely large. In fact, they're going to be managing the Deepwater Horizon settlement funds, which are going to actually put them in the billion-dollar category of endowment management. So NIFWIF has that experience, and to the extent that is helpful, I think there's also a judgment call there to what extent that experience will make a difference here in Santa Clara or not, is something maybe we could get into more. So that's what we ended up with on the evaluation. In the end, I would call it pretty much a toss-up. They're both great organizations. They have very sound investment management teams. They both have reasonable and competitive fee structures. They both have a reasonable historical performance record. And then you get to those differences that I just talked about, connections to the local community and experience with habitat endowments. So I'll stop there and open it up.
Questions?
Yeah. I have a question. Well, you're the expert. So do you really not have a recommendation? Because, VTA explored the Silicon Valley Community Foundation. And in the end, for an endowment we needed on a property, we're going to do it in-house. But, we have a whole staff for that. So, I mean, the foundation seemed great. They were concerned about the fees. Maybe we didn't investigate NIFWIF enough. We kind of we're considering them too much in the beginning or even farther along. But they had some other kind of quirky restrictions or requirements. And at one point, they told us we needed to be a 401c, you know, the charitable thing.
Yeah.
I don't know. So I mean, are they pretty much even? I mean, do you not have a recommendation as an expert in this field?
I should mention, just to elaborate on the point about the nonprofit, if you go to Silicon Valley, you will need to set up basically a shell nonprofit governed by this JPA so that the funds flowing into the Community Foundation come from a nonprofit, because that's how their lawyers tell us we can't take monies from a government agency, but we can take monies from a nonprofit. That to me is not a negative or positive. That's just an administrative, very minuscule administrative burden. But to your main question, I've talked to Edmund, of course, a lot about this, and I fully understand how he came to the conclusion he did in recommending the Silicon Valley Foundation. This investment world is so full of pitfalls and also, you know, great opportunities. You really want very experienced people. I can see the advantage of having a closer relationship to those decision makers, you know, the investment committee on the Silicon Valley Foundation appointed by the board. I could see that as an advantage. I think potentially they might have access to certain investment vehicles that a national fund manager may not, but that's somewhat speculative, and I bet Common Fund would disagree with me on that. But I'm only stating that because when you're, you know, in the Valley and given the opportunities for wealth generation from the Valley, sometimes you got to know who to know to get into those deals. And I think Silicon Valley may have a bit of an edge there, although again, Common Fund, maybe they've got connections in New York I'm not familiar with. So I guess I'm speaking as kind of a hometown boy here, that having that expertise local makes sense. And finally, I think maybe, again, to these intangibles, just connection to the local community, potentially opening up some doors to other funders that would want to help build the reserve system, something you'll get with Silicon Valley that NIFWIF doesn't necessarily have that local connection. So I understand Edmund's recommendation. I'm in full support of it in terms of choosing the Silicon Valley Community Foundation for the endowment manager. Sorry if I'm a little
wishy-washy there. No, that's okay. That's good.
On the metrics, I just want to make, on the metrics, they're very close.
Mm-hmm.
So it's more these intangibles that it comes down to.
Any comments?
Yes.
So, I mean, getting the return on investment is one part of it, but how easy are each of these entities?
How easy?
How easy are they to work with? So when it comes to get, like, let's say, like, one day, 50 years from now, we wanted to get our money out. Like, how easy is it to get our money from each one and interact with them? And, like, what are their systems? And what's the report? Is that also important to understand, as well as?
Yeah, no, great question on just sort of the relationship, the ongoing relationship and day-to-day working relationship that you would have, and how easy is that between these two options. First off, what we wanted to make clear from the start with regards to, if you will, the biggest decision you might have to make after this one, which is, would you want to terminate this relationship going forward? You can terminate, the way we've set up these options, particularly through the Silicon Valley Fund, but also NIFWIF, at any point, this board can say, we're done for whatever reason. You don't even have to name a reason. Give us control of those funds, and we're going to move them over here. Basically, both NIFWIF and Silicon Valley are acting as your agent. They're not acting as, you're not giving them the funds for them to own and act as trustee, from which they will then pay out for you the annual amounts needed after the permit term. We wanted to make sure that your board retained ownership of the funds, and we're simply hiring these folks as your agent for investment purposes. NIFWF is very clear that that's the case. Silicon Valley had to work through this nonprofit business to get there. So that's, you know, you can move at any time. With regards to the day-to-day, they're both going to be very easy to work with. We're talking about wire transfer abilities. The NIFWF has an office in San Francisco, so I got to give them credit for the fact that they are more or less local, even though Common Fund may be based, their endowment manager, investment manager may be based in New York. They're local. NIFWF headquarters is in Washington, D.C., but they have a local San Francisco office. So, and what you would do post-permit then is you would establish an annual funding target, and you would simply set up whatever recurring transfer would be necessary out of the endowment, and either of them are set up to do that very easily. So I don't think there's really any administrative difference, and I think it would be pretty simple for staff to manage.
Thank you, and I apologize. Thank you for bringing it to my attention. It's a study session. Anybody else in the public wish to comment about anything on here? Yes,
yeah,
Michael.
I have a question. In terms of the, what is it, NIFWF?
Yeah.
Using common fund. So let's say NIFWF, their cost is 50 basis points. So then they invest the money in common fund. What sort of costs or what does common fund take out?
Thank you. I should have covered that in the presentation. Very good point. When you go back to this basic formula we've talked about, the 7.25%, and in fact, let me go to the difference between the two funds here. Here, these return on investment numbers from NIFWF and Silicon Valley are both net of investment manager fees.
Okay.
So the investment managers, Common Fund, and in the case of NIFWF, and for Silicon Valley, the various managers they picked for their long-term investment portfolio, those numbers are all net of the fees that those guys would charge. So those guys, their overall goal is even higher than this because they've got to cover their fees. But again, it's very typical in this business to report returns net of fees. And so those are already taken out.
So the $9.50, let's say it was $10, and the FWIP gets $9.50. Common Fund gets $9.25.
Yeah, investment manager fees can be anywhere from, you know, 10 basis points to 100 basis points. When you get into the alternative sector, meaning limited partnerships and various hedge funds, it's harder to calculate for reasons I can go into if you like. But so you're looking, they're looking at returns, gross returns in the 8%+ arena. But when you look at a CalPERS report, all these other reports, they're going to report all that net of fees. So I think the numbers that you cited at the beginning are comparable to the numbers reported here as far as return on investment.
Yes, please.
The district has used NIFWF before, and it has ways of slowing down some returns, and they have special stuff. But my question has to do with how difficult it is to, and the whole doing the 501, you know, nonprofit kind of filing. Mm-hmm. And since we are sort of a quasi-public agency as a joint, joint powers, so maybe we need to talk a little bit about that.
Do you want to?
So I have requested from the Internal Revenue Service what's known as a governmental information letter, which is a free service that the IRS provides that basically says a governmental entity is a nonprofit. We don't know if that will convince the Silicon Valley Foundation that we don't need to go through the exercise of a 501c3. There's also a provision in the United States Code, in 26 U.S. Code, Section 170, which I think basically says that a governmental entity is entitled to deal with charitable contributions and doesn't have to be a formal 501c3. I've not had the opportunity to speak with the attorneys for the Silicon Valley Foundation to find out why they're so focused on a 501c3. But if we need to, we can establish a 501c3. It's not a hard process. It's just like another hoop to jump through. So on the agenda later is the authorization to go ahead and do that, just so that we can, you know, get that taken care of if needs be. So we're trying a multi-pronged approach here. But I don't know what their fixation is on the 501c3 when they're dealing with a government entity.
Several of the integrated regional watershed management planning entities, including CABI and the San Leandro Water District. CABI was contemplating setting up a 501c3 last time I was working in Placer County. That's what they were thinking. And they were made up of water agencies and environmental groups. So they had already created a joint powers agency. San Leandro created a San Lorenzo, excuse me. Yeah.
I hadn't heard of that water district.
You know, up in Placer County, they pop up all over the place. There's about 10 of them in Lake Tahoe. But so the Mark Twain adage really applies to Placer County. But that's, so it's not unusual for a joint powers agency to form a 501c3. Now, whether we need to or not, that's an open question.
And I would just add that, sorry if I'm repeating myself, but it would be almost invisible. And there really would be, I mean, the same staff would be managing it. You would just convene as a 501c3 board probably once a year to approve an audit, and that would be about it. So I would not suggest that this is a hurdle.
So it'd be something pretty easy to add on to the other duties of this board already without a big deal. That's what you're saying. And that makes sense. It seemed like a hoop that was almost unnecessary, but you know, that's their problem.
Question though.
Yes, and we argued with them about this, Bob and I, for quite a while, and it was their attorneys were pretty strident on it, but we'll see if this letter or some more information will change their minds. And Moore Foundation was also pretty adamant about they would need to, any money we would get from them would have to go through a pass-through, but OSA is one of their pass-throughs, so I'm saying, well, you know, so this letter that Valerie's getting may make this a moot point, but I don't know.
I'm going to have to get that app that Valerie has that has the IRS code on there. I think that'd be something very exciting. If you're asking for recommendation on what we as a board would like.
Yeah, this is discussion and recommendation, then item 5 on our agenda is actually voting on it.
Right. So all things being equal, I mean, you look at both funds, I think how they're managed, I think, is very equal. But for me, it's the fees and the fact that Silicon Valley has a lower amount of fees. I mean, the percentage-wise seems minuscule, but when you're talking millions of dollars, they do add up. And for a nonprofit such as ourselves, even though we don't have the quote-unquote paperwork, I think that's very, very important. So apples and apples, for me, the difference would be the fee structure.
Okay, and Valerie, correct me if I'm wrong, but this being a study session, it's agendized for item 5 to vote on. The most I can ask for here is any further questions, and otherwise we're done. We've received the report.
Yeah, because the item is on a formal agenda.
Okay, just we've got 15 more minutes. Yes, Rose.
So is that something, the suggestion we just heard here, to base it on fees, is that something we take up then in the item when we vote on it?
If you want to, we've got 10 minutes to do it now. I'd love to do all the discussion we can now to minimize what we need later.
I mean, are we making that decision now, or are we, we're not making that, we're just giving input. So I mean, I agree with the comment about fees, because That's really one of the biggest differences, and we're not, as you pointed out, we don't have money coming in from other places, so this is the money we're raising, and we need to make sure that, you know, well, just yeah, like in any investment
lower
we're
the fees
making,
better,
we need to really take a look at fees and try to reduce them as much as we can. I also appreciated your comment about the interest rate and making sure that we have a realistic interest rate, because having been a member of the Police Fire Retirement Board in San Jose, we struggled. Not anymore. I'm not.
I hope I'm wrong, but in five years, I'll bet we're too high. But that's,
and they've reduced it, you know, over time. They've reduced it because they want to make sure that we can attain it, and we know what we're signing up for, and we can make sure we can deliver, you know, the pension benefit at the end of the day. That's what we're trying to do. So this, we don't have anywhere to, you know, make it up. So your point's well taken.
Are there any other questions that want to be asked now? We'll open it up to the public at our meeting. I'm not expecting a great deal of additional members of the public to come here for this item, but we'll certainly open it up to them. But if there's anything else we can do, otherwise we're kind of in a 10-minute, I want to start our 3 o'clock meeting right on time.
Yeah.
So we've got a 10-minute gap right now. Are there any other questions of staff, of our consultant now about this item? Yes, Kat.
I just wanted to allow Ed to make any further comments, because you actually gave a recommendation which we can see on the agenda.
Yep.
But do you have any extra comments or information to share?
Yes, I and it sort of detailed a little bit in my staff report, but the idea, given where we are and all the, like, we're trying to figure out how to get Google involved with management for burrowing owls at Moffett. Tara and I met with the Moore Foundation a couple weeks ago. So whatever leverage we can get into that world and try to build relationships and networking, they have an annual investor, client, whatever you want to call it, meeting event at the Silicon Valley Community Foundation. And that's something we would attend and try to meet funders, try to, Post also invests their money, so Post in the Silicon Valley Land Trust, Post invests their endowment with Silicon Valley. They invest in the local community with their various charitable programs. So that's what went over with me. Also, the staff we met, at least on the investment side, pretty impressive. They all came from the private sector, and now they work for Silicon Valley. And NIPWIF's great too, but I thought the sort of the local edge, and we're part of this community, so I thought that was important. So it was those intangibles and the networking opportunities.
Good, thank you. I think that'll conclude our study session, unless anyone else has any more questions.
Recommendation.
None. That'll conclude. Take whatever break you need, and we are going to start here sharply in 12 minutes at 3 o'clock. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Oh, thank you, Supervisor Midian.
Oh, Joe's on the line.
There, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
We're starting it. Yeah. This meeting to order, and we just concluded our special meeting, our workshop, if you will, and we are now moving on to the Santa Clara Valley Habitat Agency's regular joint government and implementation board meeting. We've called it to order. We'll do a roll call. Angie.
Board members Tucker,
here.
Constantine, Tate,
Please.
Herrera,
here.
Wasserman, Semidian?
Here.
Little?
Here.
Courtney? Callan?
Here.
And Tate's here.
And member Constantine is here, but I think he just stepped in the back. All righty, we'll report from the chairs. I have nothing to add except the Giants better get going. That's it from the governing board. And filling in for Linda?
Deborah Calden from the Water District. I have nothing to report.
Thank you. And our public advisory. I'm looking, there's Walt. I was looking for him, he was behind me. Mr. Glines, anything to report? Mr. Glines. Mr. Glines, anything to report from the Public Advisory Committee?
Nothing to report, but when we get to item number 10, I would like to have a say on that one, and that's the appointment to the Public Advisory Board.
Item number 10, we'll get your comment then. You're welcome. Let the record show, Councilmember Constantine is here. That's it. We'll now go to public comments. Anyone here from the public wishing to speak about anything not on today's agenda? Seeing none. Anybody who does wish to speak on today's agenda, I will ask for it. Just please get my attention so we can recognize you. We now move on to the regular business. And I have spoken with staff, got his approval. And I'll make a suggestion to the rest of you, and anybody that disagrees, just let me know, and we won't put it on consent. But I would make a motion to put item 1, 3, 4, and 6 onto consent. 1 is approval of the March minutes. 3 is approval of the June minutes. 4 is the final report for fiscal year 16, revenue and budget, which you all have in your packet. And item number 6 is approval of Central Valley Project Conservation Program and Central Valley Project Improvement Act Habitat Restoration Program application.
So moved. Second.
We have a motion and a second. Thank you both very much.
For any implementation board item, we don't have a quorum yet. Mr. Courtney is running late.
Mr. Courtney, who's he work for? Oh, yeah. Okay. All right. So this is going to be, Angie, a governing board vote, which we do have a quorum. We have a motion and a second. Do we have anyone in the public wishing to speak about items 1, 3, 4, or 6?
Just a point of order. Yes. If this is a governing board, you can't make the motion, so we need to make a motion from somebody else.
Motion, so moved. Second. But the minutes are meetings of governing and implementation board, is that correct?
Yes, so I think what's going to happen here, and Valerie, correct me if I'm wrong, is these are governing board members making a vote regarding the governing board minutes.
Yeah. So this is a motion on governing board minutes. Minutes 3, 4, and 6 on the governing board agenda on consent.
1, 3, 4, and 6.
Yep.
Yeah. Angie, does that, Valerie, does that work for you?
So 1, 3, 4, and 6 are all governing board items. 1 is actually a joint set of minutes.
Right. My motion includes only the governing board minutes.
But they're just one set of minutes.
So you might want to take one.
Oh, we only have one set of minutes?
Separately.
Well, then let's just.
Yes, we just. Okay, why don't we take one when Rob Courtney returns?
He's here.
Rob Courtney. So there we go. Now we have a quorum. Thank you. Let's hear the motion, please, Member Herrera.
Okay, so it's a motion to approve item 1, which is a joint governing.
And is this being picked up on our audio?
Get your original.
And items 3,
your original,
4, and 6 on the governing board.
So we have a motion made.
That would be consent, all those items.
Still a second, Member Tucker? Okay, to put 1, 3, 4, and 6 on consent. No one from the public wishes to speak to any of those items. All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? None. That passes unanimously. Thank you. We now move on to item number 2, which is our executive officer's report. Mr. Sullivan.
Thank you, Chairman Wasserman. So we got some big news. Just found out today we were awarded a $2 million Section 6 grant. So thank you. Thank you. And this grant is for land acquisition. So, and it will go towards hopefully one of the properties in, that we'll discuss in closed session. Just
and quickly, I believe that amount was hoped for or reflected in the budget.
Yes, it
that's,
was.
That's what I thought.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
Good, so we're still on budget.
And then other grants, we're going to submit 2 grants to the Bureau of Rec, 1 for improving the fencing for the Water District property, the OSA Coyote Ridge property, which is enrolled in the reserve system in VTA. And that's one of the grant programs they have through their Central Valley water project. Another one is for land acquisition for $1 million, which, if all goes well, we'll use towards the Richmond Ranch property. And those will be submitted in the next couple of days. We also will, now that we got the Section 6, we're going to do a full court press in the Wildlife Conservation Board, because they promised us that they would match a Section 6 grant.
Wonderful.
Yep. And on to the Moore Foundation. Tara and I met with them and had a fantastic meeting. We were scheduled to meet for an hour. We were there for almost 2.5 hours. And they want to partner with us on several land acquisitions, two of which will be discussed in closed session. And one that they can approve at the staff level, another that they would have to go to their board based on dollar amounts, very, very similar to the way we're set up. So RGP 401 certification update, what can I say? We had a very, very simple project, the Calero restoration project, which you know, brought to your attention a few times. And it's automatically supposed to be approved by the RGP. I had to drop the Colonel General card with them on why haven't we gotten authorization from you on this, which is a pre-approved project per the RGP 18. So I let the Colonel know. He was concerned, so we're going to meet with them. They had a staff person who got everything ready before she went on special assignment to Washington, and then everything fell apart when Dr. Allen went back to LA and Sarai went to Washington. It was the same old with the Corps, even though we have an RGP. So we're going to meet with the Colonel. I wrote a letter to the Colonel also saying that we hope who replaces Dr. Allen and Tori White, who are both serving as an interim, will continue to work collaboratively with the regulated public and not continue the shenanigans that all of us in this room have either heard about or experienced personally. Because this was a really straightforward restoration project. We weren't asking for anything crazy here. So we'll see how that goes. On the positive side, things have been going very well with the regional board, even though we hadn't, they still take a long time to get you your permit. They're very thorough. Some may argue too thorough. But they haven't issued us the permit yet on Calero, but they still allowed us to begin construction without Calero, which I thought was very constructive. And they're starting to see the value of the habitat plan and how it can integrate with what they're doing. I don't know what the outcome will be of them certifying our, doing a 401 cert of our RGP 18. We may still have to go to the state board to get that issued for us, but I feel the agency's developing some very good relationships with both regional boards, and we'll see how it goes. Calero, I sort of touched on it a little bit, but I will just mention quickly that construction started on Friday, and Tara Donovan has been doing a fantastic job on that, and she's never done projects like this before, but you wouldn't know that by the way she's been managing it. So she's been doing a great job. And on the grant, I would like to thank both the staff of the agency and ICF, because we work collaboratively to put that grant together. In the future, grants like this will be written in-house, so that's part of the savings of having in-house staff. This is going to be probably surprise news for you all on page 2. The City of Mountain View is interested in potentially becoming a co-permittee. So for issues related to their shoreline activity, so the landfill, the recreation stuff, what's triggering it is burrowing owls. We'll see how that, we had one preliminary meeting with them, which was spearheaded by the Department of Fish and Wildlife, State Department. I'm cautiously optimistic. It would require us to do a plan amendment, but given things that may or may not happen at the Water District and things related to the cost of restoration, some clunkiness about the plan, extending the burrowing owl conservation actions maybe into San Benito County, not take coverage but conservation, because there are burrowing owls breeding there. There's a lot of things that are starting to bubble up that may require the need to do a plan amendment. So we wouldn't go out on a limb to do this for Mountain View if everything was going hunky-dory, but there is things that the county and other in the Water District and other the co-permittees have brought up as either they want additional coverage or they want some changes made to how the plan is unfolding. Nothing serious, but things that do require amendments. We can't just do them through policy interpretations or clarification memos. So we had one meeting with Mountain View and they want to meet again. So just to let you know, and I'll keep you posted as things unfold, and we'll see what happens.
They know where the meetings are, right?
Pardon me?
They know where the meetings are.
Yes,
right?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, yeah, good point. Yeah, we had quorum problems before, right? So we added a new staff person who is at Water District watershed planning meeting today, something that we need to get more involved with. And because now we have the staff person, we are he is at that meeting today, but I will introduce him to the implementation board in November. So his name is Jerry Haas, and just wrote down some highlights of him. I worked with him in Placer County, and he was a senior planner there, and he worked on a lot of advanced planning and current planning projects. He's got a lot of great experience in working primarily in land use planning, but he's also done conservation planning. And he's going to take over a lot of the responsibilities that had been done by in the past, either by the county or ICF. So land acquisition update, we'll just talk in closed session about that. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Any questions of Edmund from the committee? Any members of the public have any questions regarding this item number 2 on the governing board? Seeing none, we received it. That does not require a vote. We handled 3 and 4 on consent. We now move on to item 5, which is in regards to the Habitat Agency endowment. Mr. Sullivan.
Yes, so the recommendation here today is to...
And for those of you, excuse me, following us at home or here, this is what our study session was on previously. So if it seems to anyone who's not been following us for the last hour and 15 minutes, this was discussed at length over the last hour. You may see us be brief at this point. Mm-hmm. Please.
Thank you. So the I'm recommending that the governing board direct me to establish a nonprofit entity to access the Silicon Valley Community Foundation nonprofit investment program and to choose Silicon Valley Community Foundation as the Habitat Agency's endowment investment manager. I can get into the reasons for that, which I've already touched upon in the study session, or we can take it straight to a vote, however you all want to handle it.
I'll move to approve.
Second.
Move to approve and a second. Do we have any speakers from the public on this item number 5? Seeing none, do we have any further discussion among board members on item number 5? Seeing none, I'll call for the question. All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? That passed unanimously.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for all your research and for the gentleman that was here that gave them. Thank you very much. That was item 5. We did 6 on consent. Does anyone have on the board any governing board, does anyone here have any ideas they want to have on the agenda to be added at this time? No, if you don't now, that's fine. Contact us anytime you do. If the public will now excuse us, we're going to adjourn to closed session. I assume, Angie, we're going back in that back room there. And we will reconvene. Well, actually, Valerie, I asked for public comment regarding closed session at this time here. Thank you. So before we adjourn to closed session in that back room over there, does anyone here from the public wish to make any comment about anything on the closed session agenda or any comment at all? Seeing none. Okay. We are now going to adjourn to closed session. We will, when we're finished with closed session, we'll come back out here. We'll have a report out from our attorney on closed session, and then we will begin the implementation board agenda. Thank you.
Mr. Simidian, if you could please hang up, and I'll call you from the other room.
All right, welcome back, everybody. And Angie, just to confirm, because then I think I will head out. On the implementation board, if I leave, Roland is here, and you have a quorum of implementation board members?
Yes, Roland will be an alternate for Council Member Harney with the City of Gilroy, and that would make our quorum.
Okay, well, if you'll allow me just to go through a couple of items right now, I believe it leaves you with one item to do. But I'll turn to our attorney, please, Valerie, to report out on closed session.
Yes, very quickly, I'll report out that with regard to the labor negotiations item, the board gave direction to and some authorization to the executive director. With regard to the first real property negotiation item, Member Wasserman stepped out due to a potential conflict of interest, and the board gave some direction and authorization to the executive officer. With regard to the second real property item, the board gave some authorization to the executive officer. With regard to the remaining three real property items, those basically entailed simply an update and no direction or action.
Out on our closed session, we're now convening our implementation board session. I'll invite anyone from the public that wishes to speak about anything not on the agenda, Doug, to speak now. Nope. I saw you back there, so I thought I'd pick on you. All right. Seeing none there, I've spoken with our executive director, and I'll make a suggestion of putting 7, 9, and 10 on consent. But before we vote on 10, we do have Mr. Glines here with us to make a comment about number 10. But I need a motion and a second before.
Second.
Put 7, 9, and 10 on
consent. 7, 9, and 10 on to consent, and we have a second. Mr. Glines, please come forward. If you'll use the microphone here on the end, we'll be able to hear you, I believe. Oh, this one's live, too, if you want, Walt.
Thank you. In the narrative on item number 10, and I apologize for not calling Edmund earlier on it. I only skimmed the agenda going through it, but I was getting into it while sitting here. And it says that the newest member would be appointed to a four-year term. When the initial nine folks were appointed, they were on staggered 2- and 4-year terms. So I would suggest that she is filling the remainder of an existing member's term, and therefore it wouldn't be a 4-year term.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
Point made. Will the motion maker agree with that adjustment to number 10 that our staff is nodding their heads?
Yes.
And the seconder?
Yes.
As well? All right, we have a motion along with that addendum, if you will, regarding number 10 to approve 7, 9, and 10 in one vote. Any discussion? Seeing none. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? 7, 9, and 10 pass. That leaves us to item number 8. And Angie, I believe that's the last agendized item?
Yes.
Okay. Item 8 describes the outreach strategy presentation and next steps for the Habitat Agency. And if all of you don't mind, I'm going to step out. I just need to go. And you do have a quorum. And
I know.
There's no vote necessary, just view presentation. Okay.
Wonderful.
Thank you all very much.
Feel better soon.
Thanks, Mike.
Thank you.
And then who runs the meeting? You guys?
Well, it's I guess I am, yeah.
We just said
that's
on,
me.
That's it.
Yeah, I'm in charge now.
All right.
Yeah, I'm in charge.
I can't be in charge.
Take care, Mike.
Thank you. I did not know he was injured.
He's dedicated. Yes.
Chairperson Wasserman noted this is view presentation and participate in a next steps discussion. So one of the things that came up at a budget workshop, our first budget workshop, was the need to have more of a social media presence. And that's a little more complicated than I think we all thought when we set up a Twitter account and a Facebook account with this organization. We also need some kind of a better brochures and telling our story, sort of like a CV that we would bring to foundations. So handouts targeting certain user groups, certain funding organizations. So we need better kind of public relations material and handouts. And part of ICF's contract was to produce some of that material for us. What they're here today is to talk about something that goes beyond the scope of their contract. So they lay out sort of a public relations outreach strategy that would be phased in over several years. And the first phase of this strategy is part of their existing contract with us, but the second and third phase is not. So that's something I wanted to talk to you all about and have them present to you and just get some of your feedback. Public relations is not my area of expertise, and you are around it a lot more than I am as electeds and as directors of various agencies and departments. So I would like some feedback, and they're here to present some ideas to you all. So introduce our team, and I'll have them come up here and just, Shay, if you want to quickly.
Hi there, I'm Shay Humphrey. I'm with ICF, and I work with our community affairs group in Sacramento.
Hi, I'm Charlie Witkowski. I'm a senior vice president specializing in social media at ICF.
So we're going to review outreach options and recommendations and gather feedback from the board. So what does the plan say? The focus of public education and outreach activities will be to raise landowner and public awareness of reserve management goals, actions, methods, and how the public can support. So need for a communication plan. Now how robust that should be, that's why we're here to talk about that and what your expectations are. And like I noted earlier, not my area. I sometimes downplay the importance of this. I knew I needed some good brochures and some good handouts to do outreach with funders and when we go to Washington and talk to our electeds in Sacramento and in Washington. But beyond that, this is a new area for me, social media and how we will interface with that. Like we had the grant announcement today, that's something that, you know, if we were active in that world, we'd be saying, hey, this happened. So entering the next phase of implementation, we've talked a lot about that in both closed session and open session today. So the plan requires education, outreach, and engagement, and it's necessary for success. So for no further ado, I'll just have Shay jump in here and take it over. Thank you.
Hi, so as Ed mentioned, We started talking with him some months ago, and he asked us to just start thinking about what outreach might look like for the agency going forward. So we put together a very draft sort of conceptual plan that outlines some ideas and recommendations, and I'll just walk through those with you here today. So our first step was to really identify the immediate goals of the agency. And we identified those as simply raising awareness, building relationships with potential partnering organizations and others, and cultivating support from the broader public and from, you know, the various staff at the agencies and groups that you all work with on a regular basis. We also identified the key audiences that we would want to be reaching out to, and in a lot of cases probably already are, but those are everything from elected officials to the permitting agencies, all the way to the general public. And then what I'm going to walk through today are sort of the some eight strategies that we identified as things that the agency would want to look into pursuing moving forward. So the first one we have here is develop key messages, and we've identified at least a preliminary list of topics or broad themes that we would want to build key messages around, and then use those messages on a variety of platforms. We think that, as Ed mentioned, you had a really great news item here today about receiving a grant, and those are exactly the kinds of things that we would want to be communicating in a variety of different ways, targeting specific audiences. So as Ed mentioned, we would be interested in looking into providing some collateral materials, some really visually interesting, graphically focused materials that would be great leave-behinds with some of these meetings with electeds and foundations and things like that. We would also want to use those graphics and messages to update the website where appropriate, and look to opportunities to make the website more accessible for the lay audience and folks who might not know about the agency but would be interested in the benefits that the agency provides and could be potential supporters of the agency as you move forward. And then we would encourage continued use of the email news updates. The website currently has a really great feature for signing up for e-news, and we would really encourage continued use of that to stay top of mind with your stakeholder base. Specifically, we would want to think about developing an editorial calendar so that you have a comprehensive picture of what you would be looking to talk about in your e-newsletter or e-news on a semi-regular basis, with ability to, of course, add new things that come up as, you know, as news arises. And then media engagement, we think this is an important piece of building your relationships with the community is getting out there in front of the media occasionally. There are probably some great opportunities for media events and getting people excited about the work that the agency is doing. Oh, I went backwards, sorry. And then participating in events. I think this is a really great way to diversify your audience and get people interested in what the agency is doing who might not yet really know about the agency, and to showcase the accomplishments. And that could be anything. I mean, could be very simple. Could be something as simple as a farmer's market booth and distributing collateral materials and things like that. And then we also talked to Ed a little bit about doing a five-year visioning exercise to really map out where the agency would be going with outreach, education, and communications over a longer term. And we identified at least some preliminary activities that you might be interested in, which include things like goal-setting workshops, interviews with stakeholders, and other things to really get a sense of where things would be going in the long term, and to develop a vision for outreach that that supports where you see the agency going in the next 5 years, with the other, you know, meeting of goals and other accomplishments that you foresee happening. And then our folks at Olson also did a little exercise thinking about really big ideas that the agency could be interested in long term, something that could be discussed as part of a visioning process, which would be things like thinking about developing a mascot, thinking about developing a curriculum for schools, sponsoring some sort of local festival or event, or even doing some paid integrations with television or mobile apps and games and things like that. So this was sort of us having a lot of fun with the types of outreach and communications things that are in the universe of possibility. So we want to just at least consider those as well. And now I will turn it over to Charlie to talk more about social media specifically.
All right, thank you very much. So as Shay mentioned, I am with Olson Engage, which is the social media PR kind of experiential arm of ICF Olson. We were acquired 2 years ago. Work across a lot of different consumer facing, as well as do a lot of different clients, Energy Upgrade California, different things through when it comes to conservation, things like that. So have some expertise, and obviously would work hand in hand with the ICF team across this. But really just wanted to quickly kind of walk you through our philosophy and not spend too much time on that, and then get into your guys' specific challenge and what we recommend doing. So our kind of social philosophy is that it can really help build your brand. And in this case, really, what we would break it down to is increasing awareness, just overall public awareness and awareness with investors, a lot of different sectors that we think social could really make a difference for you guys, consideration. So versus other organizations, why do you guys really stand out? And then community, you know, this is obviously a passionate area with a lot of different, whether it's consumers, politicians, investors, there's a lot of conversation out there in this area, and how do we kind of put ourselves there and make ourselves stand out? So this is a fun one. So a lot of social can be really daunting because it's shifting quite a bit, and there's a million different channels, a million different ways to go at it. So we try to kind of cut through that with a way that makes sense and is also scalable. We realize that, you know, every organization, company has a different level of investment that they can make, different priorities. So this is kind of our philosophy. So Olson Engage has this thing called right size engagement. At the end of the day, it's a scalable approach that lets you factor in different budget points and make sure that you're using your money the most effectively as possible. So right insight, and we'll get into kind of how this comes to life when we talk about you guys specifically, the right audience. We obviously don't want to be speaking to people who, you know, in social it's such a broad, you can shotgun blast and get to a lot of different players that aren't relevant. So we want to make sure we nail that down and focus it right place. So when it comes to channels, as you saw in the last grid, there's probably 40 different communications platforms that are viable right now, but what makes the most sense for you guys? Content we can talk to, and then timing is really important, and then of course investment. So we'll just walk through. We have a lot of partners in this space, and we might not get to, you know, two of these, let alone all of them, but point is there's a lot of different technologies, things we can build into the back end to effectively measure the success of a campaign like this, or to make sure that it's effective when you're actually rolling it out. So it's a very technical space sometimes. So as was already mentioned, kind of where you're at right now. So there's a couple primary social channels that are set up but are largely inactive. And I'd say that in this space, that's already better than some of the other players, but there's obviously a lot more that we can do. So where we'd recommend taking you guys as a next step would be to restructure those social channels, and we'll talk through that in a little bit more detail. And then also figure out how we can create a stream of ongoing content. So whether it's Google or Facebook or, you know, any of these channels, having relevant recent content is going to be really important for you guys for a lot of different reasons, and we'll spend some time on that. And we know that's also not always an easy thing to do. There's not always great announcements like there was today. You know, how do you keep that always on approach when news isn't exactly, you know, breaking news isn't exactly flowing through the door every day? And then also, you guys are in an interesting category where there's a lot of different agencies, friendly, competitive, but how do you kind of work in that space effectively? So this is our kind of three-tier recommendation to get started, starting with a social media audit, which we, especially in a space like this, that's very complex and changing quite frequently, to make sure that we have a good handle on really what's out there, who are the important players. And I mean that not only in like the people that we know, but who is really driving conversation and making a making a mark in the space. Then education agency integration. So, you know, our goal here would be to arm this organization and partner organizations to continue to effectively execute in social. So giving you kind of the plan and recipes so that can be a continued thing for the agency. And then kind of more of a specific soft launch plan. How do we get kind of reset this along with all the other activities and get a what we call a soft launch out there with new channels, new branding, and we'll spend some time there too. For the audit, we've identified four pillars that we think would be really important for you guys. So I don't need to read through this in detail, but identifying those industry trends. So what are the most relevant areas of conversation for this sector? And then influencers. So who are the people that are really, as I mentioned before, making those, you know, our catalysts for this kind of conversation, good people for us to have relationships both offline as well as in these social channels, and making sure that those relationships continue, those conversations flow. Key partners and competitors, whether it's like Open Space Authority, there's a lot of good kind of, we call it like brand synergy across these different, you know, any sector, which we think would be something we should really look into. And then also from the executive side, often executives are the most important or one of the key players when it comes to being engaged in that conversation and set the tone for the organization and kind of weave in and weave out to make sure that the social presence is strong. So those are kind of the four main areas we'd look at in an audit. And then the audit would really inform the social media strategy. And as part of that, what we would do is do a program to educate and integrate this social strategy across this organization and its partners. So we would put together a detailed recommendation for introducing social media, not only as like, you know, everyone here knows what social media is generally, but how do we actually make it part of the culture? How do we give people the tools, processes, everything else so that it can be done in a sustainable way? So internal communications, content sourcing, even employee guidelines. For instance, whether it's, you know, a lot of good content could come from those emails that Shay was talking about, that could be repurposed in social. There might be some new ways where people in the field can capture content that's nice and organic. So that would be part of this process of education for the organization. And then the soft launch that I referenced before, there's a couple logos up here. Again, you know, we know the timing for this could be a couple years out. You know, this could be an ongoing process, so this is by no means the recommendation, but as an example, the soft launch would include kind of refreshing that branding alongside brochures and everything else to make sure that you have a really nice public-facing perception and social, and that the channels are relevant and engaged, and then making sure we have a consistent tone in social that really speaks to the organization's purpose, is consistent with all the other marketing, and is out there engaging with the community and social. And then making sure each of these channels that we decide that if they are strategic, have their own specific identity, and it's understood within the organization, you know, what Instagram is. For instance, just off the cuff, you know, Instagram is a great platform for visually compelling stuff, not as much financial funding announcements, but, you know, a perfect platform for something of this this agency's purpose to really show why it's being done, why it matters, whether it's burrowing owls or other causes. We think that's a great thing just to drive that awareness and really show the public why a lot of this is being done. And again, these are just a couple examples that would be determined through the audit and the education. And you can see from some other U.S. Department of the Interior, you know, how that's kind of done. And again, I want to emphasize that the goal is to make this so it can be done on a sustainable basis so that you guys can be present in the community, so that there's a frequent stream of news and it's done in a sustainable way that no one forgets who you are and why you're doing what you do. I think that's pretty much it. Here's kind of a breakdown of the different phases. Again, this is very, very rough, very high level at this point, but wanted to give you guys a little bit of a range of how that would usually flow in the costs. I think you're back up.
So, and I think Ed mentioned this also, we recognize that not all of this can be done right away. So we looked at these different strategies and thought through kind of what an approach might look like. And we think phasing various elements of this would be a wise approach. So we would foresee in the next sort of 3-month time frame look to develop a couple of collateral pieces as well as start to prioritize outreach activities and develop a more specific work plan. And then from sort of 3 months through the first year, be implementing that work plan and executing these activities. And one thing I think I inadvertently glossed over was one of the things we also thought might be useful for this particular agency is to invest some resources in a visual library, really high quality photography and other things might, I think, be a really good investment because you would have those resources to use in social media as well as on the website and in collateral materials and so forth. And certainly visual resources are, people love great pictures. So I think that might be a really big benefit to this particular agency. So I've kind of outlined some things might go into a work plan here, which include updating a media database, developing a media packet, developing specific e-news content, and editorial calendar, and then identifying a couple of events to participate in, and updating the website. And then in the longer time frame, 2 to 6 years, is when we would foresee conducting the social media activities that Charlie mentioned, and also implementing the visioning activities. At that point, those visioning activities would provide a longer-term plan and guidance for how things would move forward beyond that. I think that covers it. I think, Ed, what we're looking to do is just take any comments, questions, and have a little bit of a discussion about this.
A question.
Yes, so I'll open this right up for questions from the board.
So your timeline seems really long.
Yeah.
I mean, especially for social media. I mean, isn't this Silicon Valley? I mean, don't we move faster than this? I mean, 2 to 6 years for social media development or implementation, even 1 year for a website, it seems really long.
Well, certainly these things could be, these could be moved up in time, absolutely.
Part of it was we don't have, we didn't budget for most of this year, and whether we would. So this is something we'd have to budget for. So the stuff that Shay lined up in 0 to 3, we have budgeted for. Some of the stuff in phase 2, we've budgeted for. But a lot of this we haven't budgeted for. So that's problem number one. We do have a web page already that we've actually gotten compliments on.
I was going to ask about the web page.
Yeah, so it's more the phase 2 stuff, or 3, is does the board want to do this? That's the question. Because it was brought up at our budget workshop 2 years ago, why don't we have a Facebook page? And I said to the board at that time, well, there's a staff commitment to that. There's an engagement commitment. Just getting your name up on Twitter or Facebook is it's not, unfortunately, it's not that simple when you're an organization. As an individual, it is. So I took what you told me seriously, and we did create those pages at the a chagrin of some of our consultants and advising me not to. But I said the board directed me to develop a Twitter account and a Facebook account. So now that we've done that, you know, how do we want to use it? So that's the question. We haven't budgeted for it. So some of this stuff can't be done because we didn't budget for it this year. But it's something that we want to ask the board, is it something you want us to budget for next year? We may have to go out to bid on some of this stuff. Some of it's already built into their contract. So some of this they will be doing for us starting like now. But a lot of this is stuff that we are going to have to go out to bid on, I assume. So that's, it's just to start the discussion with you all on how you want to proceed. How aggressive do you want us to be doing this? So that's kind of why we're here. And they understand this. I couldn't have put this presentation together. I have a LinkedIn account. I choose not to participate in Facebook for a lot of reasons. I have trouble keeping up with email. So I'm the wrong person to be presenting on this. So that's why we got them here. They currently are scoped to help us think about this stuff. So that's why they're here. Yes, I think the time frames are what I told them to do based on budgeting and where we're at. So
any other questions?
I don't really have a question other than it sounded like you said that if the board chose to give money from, you know, on the budget, that you'd be able to catch up enough faster.
Yes, correct. Yep. So zero through three and part of, well, all of phase one and parts of phase two are currently scoped for them to do. So.
Well, you definitely need collateral for you. And
yes. Yeah. Phase three, we never scope for that.
Okay. Board Member Herrera.
Thank you. Yeah. This looks good. I appreciate your presentation. I like the website, by the way. So I have a couple questions. The library, the photo library, would that be people taking pictures or using stock photos out there? Or how would you envision that?
Where do you want to go?
You could do it a couple different ways, I think, because of the unique geography and the specificity of this area. You'd probably want to do some custom photography, and that can be done fairly cost effectively. And I know from a social perspective, that is increasingly the way to do it because it's more authentic than using the stock photography. So I would recommend kind of creating your own stock library, which again could be done in a way that it could be leveraged across email, social, and all these different channels. But that would be my recommendation from the creative side.
Okay. And I think as time goes on, there'll be more budget for getting this stuff done. But I like the fact that you're getting some of the initial things done that they're already paid for, and we're going to move ahead on them. I appreciate that. Is there any thought on down the road, and I don't know how many years this would be, would we ever want to have someone in-house that can just do some basic marketing things? I know even in my office, I have someone that handles Facebook and all that. You know, they handle newsletter. One person handles all of this, all of the things, and probably not to the level that you're talking about here, but I would think you eventually want somebody in-house that can do some things. And when would we think about that? And we have to make any decisions. Now I just want your thoughts on it.
Yes, I agree with you, Rose, absolutely.
Question?
I don't have a question, I have comments. Do you want questions first?
Just do questions first and then open it to the public, and then we'll do discussion afterwards. Any more questions?
Question. Because I'm sort of like Ed. In fact, I'm very much like Ed. I have LinkedIn. I've forgotten my password. I get all these things all the time. But I, like Councilwoman Herrera, am very impressed with the website.
And I use it, and my staff use it a lot. And I, before we launch on those other things, which I actually, you know, they seem to be evolving so fast, I would like to make sure that we maximize our use of the website and its utility, because my feeling about this is a permit, first and foremost. It's a permit for the developers and for people, and I mean, it has value for the overall public that we want to get out there, but, you know, again, the value, the real important value is that we have the ability to clear our work and make sure that that is really, really, really critical piece. I would hate to lose that aspect of things. So I don't know what, how our, if we have information on our website and about the utility of it and about, you know, sort of gathering, A, and then B, are we working with our public group, and, you know, what are their thoughts? Because that's the place I would really like to hear from.
Yes, we've made a lot of improvements, but it's been like Jill and I sitting down with Simone and other people at ICF saying we need to make this a little easier to navigate in this. So the changes have been more cosmetic and trying, but I think looking at the web page and is it doing what it should do is an excellent question. It's a work in progress, I would say. Yeah.
Well, I would hope that would be part of this.
Yes, it would be. Yes.
Any other questions? Yes.
I'll see if I can make this a question, or it might be sort of a comment too. It sort of goes to the previous comments, I guess, that as we think about, you know, the role in social media and just the sort of community engagement or public information strategy, you know, where do we want to position ourselves? Is it primarily related to the interactions we have related to these tools as we communicate with partner agencies, common staff, the developers, others, you know, whoever's using sort of our services, or do we want to move into more of the direct public interaction? I guess personally, I don't feel like we're ready to do that yet. I'm not sure if it's sort of core to our mission. And as you said, it would require to maintain sort of that level of interaction requires a lot of commitment to stay engaged at that level. So that's just both a question and a comment.
Yes, that was my concern. I didn't vocalize it very much at the workshop 2 years ago, but I was concerned by jumping into this world without a staff person assigned to managing that world. But I do think it's important for us to interact with Sacramento and with Washington and with the foundations. So that I think we need to do a better establishing our presence. I think we have to do that, both to ensure that the permit is not put at jeopardy by actions of the state and federal governments. I didn't even get into the whole regional conservation framework stuff with you guys that both me, myself, and fellow HCP, NCCP implementers were very concerned by this legislation that was being pushed by Conservation Strategy Group and the Nature Conservancy. We were concerned that it was going to undermine NCCP implementation, and we did a lot to ensure that that didn't happen. So when John Hopkins, who's an elderly man, disappears, how do we still engage with making sure that there isn't legislation or funding initiatives that undermine this? As people have said, the NCCP is the gold standard of conservation planning in California. So, and making sure that we work, so getting the message out there and what the message is needs to be done. The public thing, you're right, Rob, it's more the, that's what County Parks does, that's what the OSA does. How do we fit into that and complement that? I don't know.
Any other questions?
That was my concern too, is, you know, the Water District, we do a lot of outreach just like County Parks, and making sure we're aligned and not stepping on our toes would be nice.
I think this is the beginning of a conversation about how to do that, and these are questions I can't answer. I can tell you about the RCF stuff or about tiger salamanders, but or what burrowing owls need to survive, but I can't tell you what is the right kind of social media presence that we should have. But I do know we need better outreach to electeds outside of this room, and we need better material to present to both the electeds and to funders. We have a very inadequate brochure right now, and how that interfaces with social media and how that interfaces with our webpage and how that is one of the questions we'd ask somebody like ICF to help answer.
Are there any other questions?
Board member Herrera. I support, I appreciate the comments from my colleagues saying that we should be focused on the things that really are most important to the agency. And so in your key audiences slide, it looks like most of those initial bullets are all around what's already been said: elected officials, conservation, strategic implementation, funding organizations, co-permittee staff. So it's the last bullet that says general public. So maybe we focus on everything above that, because I think the comments are well taken that, don't want to try to do everything at once. But if we can focus on, on some of the immediate targets, maybe that will help us get implementation of this faster too, to the original question about how can we move this more quickly if we're not trying to do too much. Thank you.
Okay, any other questions? Yeah, I have one question. And this might go to both Ed and our consultants. The social audit, is that something that we would kind of figure out what our place is going to be, is whether who we reach out to? Because I believe in your answer to Courtney's question was that we're going to be focusing on electeds and funders and things like that with our social media. How does the social aspect come in with the audit?
The social audit, usually to feed into that, you'd still want to have, you would want to figure out strategically who you're going after before that versus use social to determine your audience. So assuming you guys agreed on everybody but the public, you could use social to make sure you hit those buckets and didn't spend a lot of time trying to use channels that went right straight to the public. But you would want to know strategically from an organization standpoint, which sounds like you guys are working on who are your audiences first, and then do the social audit with that, bearing that in mind. Yeah.
Great, thank you. So, okay, one more question.
Yes, Chairman, my apologies. I do have to run to another meeting. Okay. I understand that there's not going to be any action taken.
There is no action. This is going to be discussion and direction.
Okay, so once I leave, you could continue on with that. You're not going to need me for a vote.
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so at this point, there's no more questions. I'm going to open it to public comment. Someone's waving a card at me.
Doug Muirhead.
Muirhead, if you would come up to this microphone right here to the my right. I think it's still on.
We'll find out. Okay, thank you. Good afternoon. For the record, my name is Doug Muirhead. I live in Morgan Hill. I'm going to, as a member of the public, I'm going to object slightly to being at the bottom of the list. You will make the decisions that you think are most appropriate to the agency. What I intended to say was that this agency has some great partners in county parks, in the water district, and in the open space authority. And in the last few months, I've been to each agency where they received a presentation on outreach. And so I'm really a little nervous about this idea of silos. And so I am going to ask you to consider having each of these agencies, as part of their outreach, talk about their partners and what they bring to the table. And then after that, if you'd like to say, by the way, we're first among equals, or even better, we're number one, that's fine with me. But let's start reminding each other that we have these partners and you're bringing things to the table together that benefit us. So that's the point I wanted to make. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Muirhead. And Mr. Grimes, did you have?
Yes.
What would you like to say?
Well,
Kleins, and I am chairman of the Public Advisory Board of the agency. We were having a lot of trouble finding an applicant or applicants for an opening on the board. Leslie came up with the idea, I think it was she, but she put it on Nextdoor Crestwood, and that worked. We did interviews with, we offered interviews to three people, and we had two outstanding candidates. The water board today or yesterday just joined. VTA is a regular contributor. This is, you know, down and dirty stuff. Doesn't take a lot. It's like a condensed press release, but you know, that worked on the board. The work at Calero, you know, can be something like that. There's lots of little simple things where it doesn't take a whole bunch. I think in the long run, it'll be yes, but again, you know, who's our target audience at this time? Mm-hmm. And Edward, I would think that you may want to bring it to I think we meet in November next, because Danielle, our newest member, is a near expert in this kind of stuff. And there's, you know, it's, yes, we need to do all of the above, but, you know, in what phase? Thank you.
Okay, is there any more public comment? Seeing none, I'll close public comment and open it up for discussion. I think we pretty much took care of.
I wanted to just say that I remember sitting in these meetings when we were creating this agency for a couple of years, and listening to constituencies who knew they were going to end up paying into this agency be concerned about how we spend our money and not creating a huge bureaucracy that spent the money on things other than acquisition of land. So I agree with you about the fact that it's a permit first. I do think that collaterally there are all sorts of cities and other government entities all over this county that pay for community engagement programs and have networks already set up. The note that we sent out that ended up on Nextdoor, the city has a regular email place where we start of 13,000 addresses, businesses, entities, agencies, etc. And we send something through that vehicle every single day. It hooks up to Nextdoor, and it connects to Twitter, and it connects to all these other resources and other blogs and things. And so I think that we can leverage a lot off of using existing networks while we're trying to build up the agency and do the good work of purchasing the property and protecting species. So that's my comment.
Anything else? No, you go ahead. I'm last.
And this is Deborah Calvin from the Water District. My staff and the district has a photo library to die for on this stuff. And so, Ed, if you need anything, please let me know.
Yeah, I
pictures are great.
If there's no more discussion, I just want to say that, because we're supposed to be kind of giving a direction or next steps discussion. So I think that even though I don't think that we need to have a social outreach, I do think it's important, and I'll go with your recommendations, Ed, as far as reaching out to other jurisdictions, ways of getting funding, and just get our name out there. I think with those kind of things, I think we definitely need to push forward. And if this is direction that we need to go, I think that we definitely need to go forth in that direction. So phases one through one and two, I believe, would satiate that demand.
I think so. I'll discuss it with them. It's probably a little bit of three, but yeah, I think there's probably, we can come up with something that'll kind of build on the comments from both the public and the board.
Okay. I think, Shay, did you want to say something?
Yeah, I think hearing from everybody about sort of what the top priority should remain is helpful, and who the real, at least at this juncture, who the priority audiences are, knowing that as things evolve, as we move forward, there may be opportunities to expand that reach, is, I think, really helpful. And we can definitely talk with Ed about sort of recrafting things just a little bit to make sure that we're hitting those priorities.
Okay, great.
I just wanted to add, I do agree with most of the comments here, but there is still a small aspect of we need partner that give us money. I don't know who would give us the money, but I'm just saying, like, Hewlett Packard and Lucille Packard's always given money. There's people and organizations out there that are outside of this area that will contribute, that we do need to outreach to somehow. I don't know if that's in here, if that's part of the phase three, but so there is an mm-hmm. aspect that it would be really great if it was like, oh, the first people, instead of everybody sending money to this organization or that organization, mm-hmm. they'd send it to us, because we need to be able to acquire that land.
Right.
Agreed. That's all I want to point yes. out. Yes. Agreed. Thank you.
Okay. If there's no more discussion, this is a non-action item, so we'll go ahead and close item 8.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. And then I will open this up for any future implementation board initiated agenda items. Board Member Herrera.
I just wanted to say this is my last meeting.
Mm-hmm. I looked at the schedule. It starts in 2017, so it's been really exciting to be part of this. I was part of the very beginning, and I was part of San Jose voting to join in. So I've been part of the implementation and governing board the whole time. So I'm excited at where it's going, and good luck in the future, next year and beyond.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you, Rose.
All right, with that then, we'll adjourn the implementation board.
Okay.
Next time.
Thank you. Well, good luck, Rose.
What is this? Mm-hmm. I say chamber. What is it?